As I was thinking and meditating about the topic, this is what came to my mind. That is from Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2, and that is the title is Christ, the Treasure of Wisdom and Knowledge. Christ, the Treasure of Wisdom and Knowledge. That's the title. And I'll be going through 10 verses 1 to 10. Quickly, I will try to finish it in time. Chapter 2, verse 1, when we read, Paul is mentioning about his conflict. You know, for I want you to know what a great conflict I have for you and those who are in Laodicea, and for as many as have not seen my face in the flesh. It's not a conflict of interest because he doesn't like somebody, or it is not an argument or, you know, division, but it is a conflict because he is unable to see the people in flesh, just like we, as we are now, right now, right? The COVID, you know, we are not able to see face to face, right? At least we are seeing through the Zoom, thank God for that platform that God has given us. But those days, there was nothing like this. So Paul was longing to meet the, you know, because why, if you read chapter 1, verse 7, they heard the message through Epaphras, and that's how the church was established there. So Paul, even though was willing to go there, he couldn't go. He was longing to go and see. But then he comes to know about the wrong teachings which has come in the midst of the church. It started off in Colossian church as Colossian heresy, and then it spread to even Laodicea, which is 15 kilometers from Colossae. And so there was an issue about believing in Jesus Christ, the humanity of Jesus Christ, and the power of Jesus Christ. And there were people who were teaching this Gnosticism, Docetism, and the Jewish mysticism, and so many other false teachings, and saying that you need a secret knowledge to approach God, and they made it tough for any ordinary person. So there was a confusion in the church, and Paul wanted to come in person and teach them and confirm them to grow in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. So he's feeling so much troubled. I want to come, but I'm unable to come. That's what he says in verse 1. So then he goes on, you know, what is the secret of knowing Jesus, and what is the speciality of knowing, and how easily God has made Jesus available as a reflection of God himself. That's what we find in verse 2. He says, let that there your hearts may be encouraged. See, even though I am away, I am not able to reach you, I want you to be encouraged in your heart. Don't be discouraged by the false teachings which are trying to take place and take you away from the central focus of Jesus Christ. When he says heart, it is not just heart alone. It is the will, the emotion, and you know, the intelligence, everything together. It is the whole personality that he's trying to say. So be encouraged as a person, because Christ has given life for you. Then how you can be encouraged? The reason is that you should be knit together in love. You know, when you see the sweater being knit, or, you know, a mat being knit, or things like that, you will know that how closely and tightly that it is woven together, right? Otherwise, you know, if there is gap, the purpose of making that sweater or the carpet or things like that, you know, it is not very useful. So it is so thick, so closely knitted the same way. He is telling, let you, all of you, be knitted in the love of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Let there be no gap. Let there be no difference. Let there be nothing will separate you, that you will be able to walk together as community, amen, stronger in the Lord, exhibiting the love of Jesus Christ, which will cover all the, you know, simple things of difference, or things which are dividing you. Hallelujah. Well, if people see they should be able to see only the love of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. It is so thickly packed. That's what he's saying. So when you are, you know, when you're strengthened in your heart, or in other words, when you're strengthened in the Lord and you're covered and united in the love of Jesus Christ, it will help you to attain all the riches of the full assurance of understanding to the knowledge of the mystery of God, both of the Father and of Christ. Hallelujah. What is stopping you? What is hindering you, not allowing you to attain the fullest measure of assurance and understanding in your life? Love is less. We have gaps. We have complaints. We have divisions. We have disagreements. We have arguments and all those things, which is producing a gap that we are not able to walk together. Hallelujah. You know, the greatest gift, when you read in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, you know, prophecy will stop sometime later. Speaking in tongues will stop. Healing will stop. All the things. But there is one thing that will not stop. What is that? Charity or love. Hallelujah. So, you know, if we should be filled with that, so that we will reach that fullness and there will be assurance of understanding about Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the mystery of God. If you want to see God, see Jesus Christ. Examine Jesus Christ. Go closer to Jesus Christ. You can see who God is. Amen. Because God is holy and nobody can see him. And in that holiness, we cannot enter because he is so holy that in the holiness of God may consume us. When we see Jesus Christ, who is the mystery of God, we can understand both the personalities. Hallelujah. Thank God. So he's telling, you know, there is a full assurance of understanding to the knowledge of the mystery of God, both of the Father and of Christ. Verse 3, when he comes to verse 3, he says that in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. In Jesus Christ. So Jesus Christ is the treasury house. Amen. When you don't understand, or when you have confusion, when you have doubt, when your love is decreasing, when you feel that you are weak, what do? Go to the treasury house of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Where there is fullness of who God is. You will understand how great God is, how mysteriously that he's able to lead you and take you to the place where you want. He can lift you, elevate you, and bless you, and continue to, lead you in every step of our life. Hallelujah. Thank God. There is no lack of treasure. There is no lack of wisdom and knowledge in the presence of God. Hallelujah. Amen. So the complete revelation of Christ is seen. Complete revelation of God is seen in Christ. What do? Every time we go to Jesus Christ. Examine him. Ask him, Jesus, I want to see God. Hallelujah. I want to know you. Hallelujah. Yesterday's understanding is not enough. Yesterday's commitment is not enough. Yesterday's prayer is not enough. Yesterday, what we have been strengthened is not enough. Something new that we have to. So there is an intimate knowledge of God is found, revealed in Jesus Christ. He says, it is not achieved by rituals. It is not achieved by ceremonies. It is, everything is known only when we go to Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So that means we have only one source in this world. All the other things are man-made. The rituals are man-made. The traditions are man-made. Conveniently, people have made. This is how it has to be. But let me tell you, the only source for us to know who God is to go to the resources, that is Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Then the next words, then he continues to give a warning. The world is offering something. In verse 4, he says about a deception. You know, what is deception? Deception is from far you see that there is some truth. But when you go near and personally examine, there's no truth. Right? Now, what is that deception that the world is offering? the world is offering, you know, speaking nicely, persuasive words, right? You see, if you carefully watch sweet talks, you know, people give so nicely. Convincing speeches, salesman techniques, management principles, crafty words. These are all used, you know, this is all the selling process that the world is having. Hallelujah. It could be hypnotism. It could be, you know, witchcraft. It could be, you know, anything for transcendental meditation. It could be anything for that. So what do they say? So by persuasive words, they deceive people. Hallelujah. Once, you know, our greatest grandma Eve, Satan came and asked this, you know, asked this question. What is that? Did God say so? Did he really say so? You know, then immediately the doubt came inside the great grandma at that moment. Oh, he didn't say like that, but probably God would have meant like, you see, that's how persuasively, convincingly, you know, deception of the world is introduced. Hallelujah. That's a warning. World is so crafty, I tell you. World has a lot of techniques. And Satan has been in a very modified, gentle, hallelujah, very glamorous way that he is persuading people. Our young people are all carried away by that. Our children are all induced by the doctrines of those crafty techniques where they are deceived. Amen. If you don't want to be deceived, what do? Go to the treasure house. That is Jesus. That's what he's trying to say. Truth is not there. Truth is not in the lofty words, right? You know, so he's telling, go to the treasury house where you will be filled with the wisdom to live for day to day and the knowledge to discern which one is right and wrong. Hallelujah. Many of us do not have the time right now because we're so busy. Oh, we are busy with the things of the world that, you know, we don't have time to go to the feet of Jesus Christ. That's what one of the, sisters of Martha, you know, sisters of Lazarus, you know, even she was, the other sister was so busy. She sat at the feet of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. She was just listening to every word which was coming from Jesus Christ. Amen. She didn't worry about the outside circumstances or what was happening to the whole world. She was just listening to the wisdom and the knowledge that was coming to Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Turn your ears to the treasury house so that you will know who God is. You will know what his power is. You will know, oh, hallelujah, how he can lead you in this wicked world in the midst of all the confusion and the sickness that he is able to lead us. Hallelujah. Now, Paul, you know, he says he rejoices. You know, verse 5, he says, even though I am absent in the flesh, I am with you in my spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ. Amen. You see, he is rejoicing to see that your steps are ordered. Number one. Number two, he says that your faith will grow. You will not be dilly-dally, or you will not be wavering. You will not be tossed to and fro, but you will be steadfast in your in the faith that you have received in Christ. Hallelujah. Things are tempting. Things are alluring. Hallelujah. As I told, the deception of the world is just, you know, taking people into their fold. Hallelujah. But thank God. Hallelujah. God can make you steadfast. God can make you to be firm in the faith that he has given in you. Hallelujah. And your orders can, your steps can be ordered. Hallelujah. That's the prayer of a missionary or a pastor or somebody who is in charge. Then as you continue from verse 6 to 8, our loyalty to Christ is mentioned. You know, he's asking a question, or he's stating the whole truth of, you know, how you came to the Lord. Verse 6, as you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him. He's asking, how did you receive Jesus Christ? Jesus Christ came to you because he died for you. He gave life. He was willing to pay the cost to redeem you. You were in the clutches and the bondages of sin, as we heard just now in, you know, holy living. In the Bible study, I think we heard, you know, holy living cannot be achieved by our, you know, intelligence or by the practices that we receive. Hallelujah. John Uncle, I think he mentioned about it, right? It is only by Jesus and his power. Hallelujah. Only by staying in the word of God and knowing Jesus intimately. So he's asking this question to Colossian church. What is that? How did you receive Jesus Christ? You received because Jesus took the first step of paying ransom for you. He forgave your sins. He took you out of the miry clay. He made you to be firm, and he gave you power to overcome the sin. So he's asking, so therefore, having received Jesus Christ, what do you do? Don't run away. Walk in him. Amen. Dwell in him. Live in him. Oh, be filled with his presence. Hallelujah. So that nothing will shake you. Then he says, he's also explaining about it like a tree, you know, example of a tree. How, you know, the other last 1.5 months, there was an experiment in our house. Gracie was doing that, you know, about an avocado seed. You know, well, it was almost 3 weeks. There was no change in it. But the fourth week when we saw, there was slightly roots coming. And there's no leaf, there's nothing. But fourth or fifth week, we saw that only the roots are going. You know, the bottle was tall bottle, but the roots are growing and growing and growing and touching the bottom of the bottle. Hallelujah. Still, there's no leaves. There's no bark. There's no plant, nothing. Only the first, the roots were going. I was just seeing, my, how much roots it is going down. Hallelujah. I learned a lesson, you know, the more the rooted the plant is, you know, the more, the stronger it grows up. Hallelujah. It was an experiment, live experiment. So it took 6 weeks for us to see that an avocado seed to come out. And now the tree has come out. Hallelujah. Amen. You know, so that means it is, Paul is explaining, you know, giving an analogy by saying that in the same way be rooted. Hallelujah. That means the more deeper you go in your life, in your root, you will not be shaking. Hallelujah. He says, rooted and built in him and established in the faith as you have been taught, abounding it in with thanksgiving. You know, the signs that you are rooted, how do you know that? You know, you won't be shaking. Hallelujah. You will be steadfast in your moves. Number two, you will be built stronger. No waves can toss you. No cyclone or storms can put you down. Hallelujah. You will be built. That means you will be stronger. Then he says, you will be established in the faith. That means it's not only you, you will also try to establish others who are knitted in the love. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank God for the power of love in which the church is knitted. Hallelujah. Nothing can separate us from the love of Jesus Christ, that you are established in the faith and you are trying to encourage others also to be established in the faith. Hallelujah. As you have been taught, you know, there's a teaching that we learn from Jesus Christ, from the wisdom and the knowledge of Jesus Christ. And then it, you know, goes to a maturity level. What is that? Abounding in thanksgiving. That means whenever you open your mouth, your maturity will be seen by the way you give thanks to the Lord for everything that is happening. It could be sickness. It could be trouble. It could be crisis. It could be unexplainable incident that is taking place in your life. But you will not grumble, but you will be always giving thanks. Lord, I thank you. I thank you. I give you glory. Hallelujah. That shows how much you are matured. Hallelujah. How much you are rooted, how much you are firm in the Lord will show when you say, Lord, I'm thankful, hallelujah, even for this situation. I'm thankful when I don't see anything still. I believe that you are able to hold me and lead. That is where the maturity is explained about a believer. That's what he's trying to say, abounding in it with thanksgiving. Thank God. When you start giving thanks, you know, you are already growing towards maturity. Hallelujah. Your grumbling reduces. Your complaining nature reduces. Your murmuring reduces because God is glorified when you give thanks. Hallelujah. Are we doing that? Or are we complaining about everything? Hallelujah. Let your maturity, your establishment in faith, you are rooted in Christ, may be seen by others by the giving of thanks in your life. Hallelujah. And as we continue, the second warning he is giving. Verse 8, beware lest anyone cheat you. You know, deceiving and cheating. This is taking place every day. Hallelujah. How many of us have cheated, you know? You know, we were promised so many things. Some companies promised something, or, you know, some people promised. What happened? There has been cheating, and it is taking. Now, here the cheating the world is offering is through philosophy and empty deceit. Philosophy, empty deceit, according to the tradition of men and according to the basic principles of the world and not according to Christ. Christ never cheats. Hallelujah. Remember, in even the worst situation, when everyone deserts you and go, hallelujah, Christ will not cheat you, hallelujah. But the world, you know, it has fancy things. It has deep, you know, plans to deceive and cheat people through the philosophy, the empty deceits, the traditions, the principles of the world. Hallelujah. There are so many, I cannot explain all those things because it will take an hour at least to explain what is that. But one thing, the second warning is cheating. Deceiving, cheating. This is taking place. So the warning is that don't get deceived. Hallelujah. Don't be cheated. There's only one way out to be away from this cheating and deception. What is that? Go to Christ. Hallelujah. Who is the treasure house of your knowledge and your wisdom. Hallelujah. Thank God you don't need a mediator. You don't need anybody's help. As Joshua Putankle just mentioned in the psalm, you know, I was not satisfied. I went to the word. I started studying by myself. I wanted to know the truth. Hallelujah. That should be the heart desire, that go to the treasure house. That is Jesus, who is the mystery of God, who will reveal who God is. Hallelujah. You may be having less knowledge about the world. Don't worry about it. You may not be informed about what is happening in this world. But if you know Jesus very well, hallelujah, you will know God more than, amen. Hallelujah. And that is enough for you to survive in this world. Hallelujah. That's why he says, again confirming in verse 9, for in him dwells all the fullness of the God bodily. Hallelujah. You know, the Gnostics came and said that, you know, there is the humanity of Jesus is not correct. It's fake, right? It is only a phantom figure, right? Jesus is not real. That's what they were telling, because of the Gnostic and the Docetic teachings which were prevalent at the time. So he's trying to say, no, in Jesus Christ, in the humanity of Jesus Christ, dwells in the full Godhead bodily. Hallelujah. Everything pertaining to God, everything in relation to the power of God, everything in relation to the greatness of God, everything connected to the redemption of God is dwelling in Jesus Christ. That means you look to Jesus Christ and you understand God completely. Hallelujah. Amen. And you are complete in him. Hallelujah. Who is the head of all principality and power. That means whenever we confess, Christ Jesus is Lord, we are declaring him as the anointed Messiah. We are declaring him as the Son of God. We are declaring him as our Savior. We are declaring him as Yahweh. Hallelujah. We are declaring him as the sovereign Lord who is in control of us and also the universe. He's not only controlling us, but he's also controlling the universe also. Hallelujah. Amen. So that means, you know, when we are deeply rooted and grounded in him, our helpless nature goes away. Our hopeless nature goes away. Our stumbling nature goes away. That, you know, we can be free from the clutches of the bondage of sin, and we can be victorious because our focus is towards Jesus Christ, who is the mystery of God. You know, he says, when he uses that word cheating, the word is captivating. You know, captivating means trapping people, carrying you just like that, rob you. Or in other words, you know, from truth, they take you to slavery. You are already in truth, but you know what happens? They trap you so that you will not know that you will be in slavery very soon. Hallelujah. How does it take place? It is legalism. It is asceticism, mysticism, you know, all those isms. How does it come in you? When you are lazy instead of going to the treasure house, When church fails to go to Jesus Christ, who is the treasure house of wisdom and knowledge, you know, lazy minds is the workshop for deception. Hallelujah. They come out with all. So what do we do? Fill your minds with Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Be always filled with the knowledge and the wisdom of Jesus Christ. In Christ dwells all fullness. Hallelujah. Open your mouth and say, wherever you are, in Christ dwells all fullness. What does it mean? It means the essence of God, the total sum of God is in Christ. Hallelujah. You don't have to add anything. You don't have any secret formula. You don't add anything because Jesus is complete. He is above all. Hallelujah. The absolute deity of God is in Jesus. That means Jesus is sufficient. Hallelujah. Jesus is able to meet all your physical needs and your spiritual needs. Jesus is able to redeem you. Hallelujah. Jesus is able to give you victory over principalities and the powers of darkness. And there is nothing above his name. Hallelujah. Rejoice together to declare, oh, in him remains, in him resides all the fullness of Jesus, all the fullness of God. Hallelujah. Let me conclude here. My time is up. He is able. Hallelujah. Open your mouth and say, he is able to meet all my needs. Hallelujah. Because all the fullness of Godhead is there in him. Hallelujah. What is your need today? It could be sickness. It could be financial. It could be some other issues that you have not told this morning. Hallelujah. But I would like to tell you, the fullness of Godhead is in him, that he is adequate enough. He is able enough to meet your needs. Hallelujah. It could be physical, spiritual, financial. It could be about somebody who is to be saved. Hallelujah. He is able. And not only that, who is the head of all principality and power. No power is above the power of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. He can give you victory over. Hallelujah. And the name of Jesus is above every name. Hallelujah. Christ, the treasure of wisdom and knowledge. Let us not be deceived. Let us not be cheated by the world. Let us not go according to the traditions of men. Let us not go according to the philosophy of this world. Let us walk in him. Understand Jesus Christ so that we will see Christ and the Father and his glory. We will not walk in darkness, but we will walk in light.